Let's get ready to unlock the secrets of creating an Oracle Real Application cluster in AWS. Access our main site, flashgrid.io. Navigate to the right side where you will find the section titled FlashGrid Cluster for Oracle RAC. Within that section, locate and click on the AWS button. Select the Launch button. On the pop-up window, you will see two buttons, one for two RAC nodes and another one for three RAC nodes. If you require four or more nodes, kindly send us a support request and we will assist you in creating a configuration file tailored to your needs. Let's select the two-node cluster option. The launcher consists of 15 sections for this version. The initial section provides information about the cluster. Customize the following fields based on your specific requirements. The first field, cluster name, is also included as part of the scan name. If you name your cluster as MyRAC, your scan name will be MyRAC-scan, followed by the domain name. Select the AWS region where you would like the nodes to be deployed. Choose the time zone for the cluster nodes and proceed by clicking Next. In the following section, you will need to provide details about the operating system and AMI. We offer support for Oracle Linux 7, 8, Red Hat 7, and Red Hat 8. Let's proceed by selecting Oracle Linux 7. Please ensure that your AWS account has an active marketplace subscription for FlashGrid with the selected operating system. To subscribe or view FlashGrid software fees, please click on one of the following links. In the section dedicated to the database version, we present multiple choices for installing the software. No database software installation, RAC, and single instance. If you choose not to install the database software using the launcher, you will need to manually install it once the initialization process is finished. To simplify things, allow our launcher to handle the software installation for you and select RAC as a preferred option. When it comes to the database version, you have the flexibility to select multiple options. Currently, we provide support for versions starting from 11.204 up to 19c so far. You have the choice between three editions: Enterprise Edition, Standard Edition, and Standard Edition 2. In the fields for Database and GI Release Update, please select the appropriate release update that matches your environment. We highly recommend reading all the text provided in the label section. For instance, if you plan to utilize ACFS on Oracle Linux 8 or Red Hat Linux 8, an additional GI patch is necessary. Please refer to the Oracle documentation mentioned in the context for further information and details. Using the information provided in the previous section, we generate hyperlinks for Oracle installation files. The first file pertains to the RDBMS home, the second one is for the GI home, the third one is the GI release update, and the fourth one is the OGVM release update, and the last one, OPatch version that is necessary to apply these patches. To obtain instructions on how to enable access to these files, please refer to our knowledge base article. Once you have uploaded the files to the S3 bucket, please enter the /folder information in this field. To proceed, I will use the placeholder value /demo here. However, please make sure to replace it with the actual and correct value for your specific situation. Please specify the region of the S3 bucket if it differs from the target deployment region. If you have enabled public access for the bucket, please leave the IAM role field blank. Otherwise, indicate the corresponding role here. Note the launcher tool is unable to verify access to the required files if public access is not enabled. If any file is missing, the software initialization process will fail. We can only confirm the accessibility of the files and cannot perform any content verification. Therefore, please ensure that the files are not corrupted before proceeding. Note, if you are creating the IAM role using the AWS CLI, instead of the AWS Management Console. It is necessary to create an instance profile with the same name as well. All the information I have mentioned regarding the role is also documented in the knowledge base article. In the node section, you have the option to specify node hostnames, AZ distribution, and VM type. The hostnames must have the same length. To minimize latency when placing nodes across availability zones, it is recommended to use an optimal AZ assignment. For more information on this topic, you can click on the following link. Please read this article carefully. From the illustration, we see that the lowest inter-AZ latency is between these two zones. For a 2-rack node cluster, placing database nodes in these zones will be optimal. The current node can be placed in any other AZ because it's not sensitive to network latency. AWS maps the physical availability zones randomly to the availability zone names. The mapping is different for each AWS account. This approach helps to distribute resources across the availability zones in an AWS region, instead of resources likely being concentrated in availability zone A for each region. To address this issue, there is an additional step which involves matching letters to IDs. This process can be clarified by referring to the relevant knowledge base article. Please select the appropriate letter at this point to ensure the correct matching process. In the drop-down box, select the VM type for each individual node. For example, if we choose this VM type, R6i 16x large, you will have 32 cores. Let's clarify, there are real number of cores, not vCPUs. 512 GB memory and DCPS throughput. All database nodes in the cluster must have the same VM type. So please ensure that you choose the same type for the RAC2 node as well. However, the current node should be a smaller VM compared to the database nodes. Please select an appropriate smaller VM type for the quorum node. We have specific notation in the list indicating which types can be used exclusively for the quorum node. As we mentioned, the quorum node is a small VM that serves the purpose of hosting an additional voting file for the grid disk group, an additional copy of ASM disk group metadata for all disk groups. In two-node cluster setup, there is an additional small VM known as the quorum node. This means that the cluster consists of a total of three nodes. The cluster remains operational as long as at least two nodes out of three are online. For deployments on EC2 bare metal instances or dedicated hosts, please see instructions. Furthermore, from this point, you have the option to enable EC2 instance termination protection, which is highly recommended for production deployments. In the storage section, please specify the names of the disk group that will be utilized in your cluster. Enter the number of disks per node for each representative disk group. For example, if you indicate 3 disks per node, another 3 are attached to another database node, and data will be mirrored using ASM redundancy. For 2-node cluster, you will have normal redundancy, so two-way mirroring. In case of having 3-node cluster, the redundancy will be high, which corresponds to three-way mirroring for data protection. Indicate the size of each disk. In this example, data disk group has 3 disks per node and each disk is 2000 GB in size. Each disk group provides a specific amount of IOPS and megabytes per second, which can be adjusted based on your requirements. So data disk group will have 3 times 2000 GB available space. As mentioned, the additional 3 disks are attached to the second node. However, it's important to note that these disks will not contribute to extra free space since they are used for mirroring purposes to ensure data redundancy and protection. Please note that the grid disk group, which is automatically configured for VOLT and OCR, Oracle Cluster Registry, is not indicated in this section as it's created automatically by FlashGrid. By default, GP3 volumes are used that can provide this number of IOPS and megabytes per second. Please use the appropriate buttons to add or remove these groups as needed in the configuration. To enable built-in encryption on EBS volumes, select the corresponding checkbox. For using customer-managed KMS key for EBS encryption, specify name of the key. Keep it blank to use the AWS managed key. For more details, see this AWS documentation. For clusters where the database nodes have a large amount of memory, it is highly recommended to utilize huge pages. This is because the default option, which uses small pages, can introduce additional overhead to the CPU. When the VM size changes, the number of huge pages will be automatically updated to align with the new configuration. The first field indicates the percentage of system memory allocated to SGA plus PGA for all databases on the system. This will be referred to as database memory in the future. In the second number, the percentage of the database memory for SGA is shown. As you know, PGA cannot use huge pages, only SGA benefits from it. These numbers will be used to calculate the number of huge pages on the system. In this section, indicate ports for scan and local listeners. You must keep them different. In our case, 1521 will be used for scan and 1522 for local listener. In the network section, there is an option that is initially unchecked to create a new VPC for this cluster. This is commonly used for testing purposes. For production clusters, the company typically has an existing VPC where the node should be deployed. For existing VPC, indicate subnet IDs for each AZ. You can adjust the entries by adding or removing them as needed using the provided buttons. Indicate security groups in case of using existing VPC. On this page, you also have the ability to assign public IPs to the VMs. However, for production systems, it's generally not recommended to enable this option. Most probably, you will use a VPN to establish a connection with the cluster nodes. When using existing VPC, please make sure that the following access is open. All traffic between cluster nodes open for inbound and outbound. TCP ports 1521 or customized scan listener port and 1522 or customized local listener port for client and app server access. TCP port 22 for SSH access. To facilitate this test cluster, we will create a new VPC and also assign public IPs. In the 10th section, please specify the domain name that will be configured in the operating system. The domain must be in a zone hosted on your DNS servers. If using Route 53 for DNS on the database clients, enter the hosted zone ID to automatically add DNS records for scan address and DB nodes. Leave blank to add the DNS records manually. Keep this list empty if using Route 53 or creating a new VPC. Add the DNS servers if using custom DNS servers in existing VPC. Please provide the email addresses where alerts should be sent in the event of failure during cluster operations. It is not recommended to use individual user addresses. Instead, it is suggested to use a distribution list address or a select channel address for more effective communication and coordination of alerts. Optionally, enable sending alerts directly to FlashGrid support. If you check this box, please ensure that HTTPS traffic is enabled to the specified address. This will allow us to receive alerts from your system, including information such as the system name, host name, source IP, license status, and error details. Upon receiving these alerts, we can promptly notify your team and offer appropriate recommendations to address the situation effectively. Optionally specify tags that will be attached to the EC2 instances and to the EBS volumes. Do not add name or cluster tags. These tags are configured automatically. Please enter your contact information. This will allow us to provide you with a better support for this system. Validate the configuration. After the validation completes, you will see the following page. As you see, the CloudFormation template has already been generated and can be downloaded from here. You have a flexibility to modify the configuration if you believe there were mistakes or changes needed in the previous sections. You have the option to download the configuration file, which can be useful for preserving the values that were specified throughout this process. This allows you to save and refer back to the configuration as needed. If you intend to redeploy the same cluster or set up another cluster with identical settings, you can easily upload the saved configuration file and follow the same process. This eliminates the need to re-enter the values manually, providing a convenient and time-saving approach to reproduce the cluster configuration. Click Launch FlashGrid if you are satisfied with the result. You will be redirected to your AWS account. As you can observe, the launcher has generated a CloudFormation template tailored to your requirements. This template is then submitted to the Amazon for the deployment of the cluster. EC2 instances, disks, and all infrastructure will be created by this template. Click Next. Specify stack name and correct public SSH key. You must have the corresponding private key to be able to connect to the cluster nodes. Please continue clicking the Next button until you reach the page displaying the Submit button. Once the stack creation is completed and the EC2 instances are provisioned, you can connect to the first node by using EC2-user account and the appropriate private key. After connecting, check the message of the day for any important information or system updates so you can confirm that the software initialization phase was successful. This phase typically takes around 2 hours to finalize. During the software initialization phase, the following tasks are performed: configuring system parameters, installing Oracle GI and RDBMS softwares, patching them, configuring real application cluster, creating disk groups, and updating settings. The final step remaining is for you to either create a new database or migrate an existing database to the cluster. Once the initialization process is complete, you will be presented with the following message of the day containing post-installation instructions and steps. To safeguard the cluster against accidental deletion, it's necessary to enable instance termination protection. As you remember, we have already taken this precautionary step from the launcher. Add records to the DNS servers used by clients and app servers. The hostname of the first database node and VPC IP address. The same way, hostname of the second node and IP address. Disable database features that you do not have a license for. See helpful knowledge base articles and CLI commands, for example. To create a database, see the following article. To configure client, check this. To test alerts from this cluster. The command FlashGrid cluster is one of the mostly used commands. Let's examine its output to understand the information it provides. As you see, the overall status of the cluster is good. This cluster consists of 3 nodes, 2 database nodes, and 1 quorum node. The disk group section contains 3 disk groups, data, FRA, and grid. Their statuses are good. They are mounted on all nodes. Redundancy type is normal. You can see total and free megabytes. Number of offline disks, lost disks, information about the resynchronization. Read local is enabled for all disk groups, which means that read requests are served from local copies. In the vote column, it indicates that the voting files are only present in the grid disk group. All 3 voting files are online. Another important command is FlashGrid health check that analyzes system logs and generates a verbose output about your system. Before going live or during the troubleshooting phase, it's important to collect diagnostics from the cluster. This can be achieved by running a simple command FlashGrid diags upload all. This command will establish connections to each node, retrieve the relevant logs, and transfer them to our designated location. Before going live, we recommend that you review our article to ensure that you are fully prepared for production. If you have any technical questions, please feel free to send us a request using this link. Thank you for watching this video. If you have any questions, you can also navigate to our main site. Depending on the question type, you may need to contact either our sales team or our technical support team.